West Hollywood lecture series for the MA in Aesthetics and Politics at through CalArts. My name is James Wilchin. I'm the interim director of the program and I guess the organizer of these talks. First, per usual, I'd like to thank a few people. John D'Amico for allowing us this great space. Amanda Carlson for putting everything together. And from CalArts, the Dean, Amanda Beach, who's continuing support, makes this happen, and Alicia Manzano. And finally, I keep forgetting this, but not tonight, my TA, Dylan Howell, who's great in putting a lot of this stuff together. So anyway, with all that, it's a great pleasure to have a book launch and the two editors to walk us through some of the key factors, key elements. This talk is entitled The Stakes of Parametricism, Architecture and Politics. And we have Matthew Poole on my right, a curator and writer living in Los Angeles. As of September 2015, he's the chair of the Department of Art at Cal State University San Bernardino. And previously, Matt was the program director for the Center for Curatorial Studies with the Department of Philosophy and Art History at the University of Essex in Colchester, UK. And on my left, Manuel Shvartzberg is an architect and writer living in New York City. He has worked for, among others, Rem Koolhaas and was project director for David Chipperfield Architects in London, where he led a number of international projects between 2006 and 2012. Schvartzberg is currently a candidate for the PhD in the architecture program and graduate fellow of the Institute for Comparative Literature and Society, both at Columbia University. So, without further ado, please welcome Matt and Manuel. Well, while you're doing that, and the book, okay? Yeah. It's out.
Woo!
Yeah, well, thanks for coming. Thanks for so many of you turning out. It's great to see you. There was an imperative for us to promote our book, but really because it came out of a conference in 2013? Yeah, 2013, which was organized in conjunction with the MA in Politics and Aesthetics at CalArts. When Arnaud de Beauvau was directing that program, and we, Manuel and I, produced a conference, most of whom, the people who were involved, are contributors to this book. So we, we were delighted to come back and, to sort of show the book. But we're not. In many ways, it's not really a book launch. Manuel and I wanted to do something which kind of showed where our work has jumped from and to currently after the conference and after the production of the book. So we are going to talk for sort of 5-10 minutes about the book and talk about it as a project, as an ongoing project, with our own interests, different interests, different approaches to questions of aesthetics and politics. Through the lens of architecture and various socio-political issues. And then Manuel and I are going to give papers, basically, which is new work from both of us, which, as I say, has been spawned by both the work we did for this book, we were the editors, but we also have essays in there. And we're going to give papers for about half an hour each, so it should be about an hour and a half, and we'll have questions at the end.
So, thank you, James, for the introduction. It's really nice to be back here. It's almost really like coming home, institutionally. And to briefly touch upon how this project fits in a kind of very broad sense within the kind of critical discourse of architecture. I think that's maybe something that might help frame the content and also its significance, what we think is the significance of this book beyond the narrow claims that are made in it. And so within architecture, the architectural theory and history and theory discourse is quite a small discourse. Actually, these 2 days, Thursday, Friday, is the current architectural historians conference in Pasadena. That happens every year somewhere different. This year it happens to be in Pasadena. And you know, you have maybe, what, 300 people or something there. It's very small. You know, that's like the state of the discipline. So equally, in a way, the claims and the preoccupations of the discourse have also been very provincial. Architectural history and theory until the 1960s was very wedded to a kind of highly modernist paradigm, a kind of heroic narrative of social change, and a kind of very deterministic one, really about the promises of modernism. And so that the history and theory was really, on the whole, very much about giving a foundation to that movement. And since the 60s, the field really kind of became, you know, broke down, it kind of became pluralized. I'm simplifying here a lot. From the 70s on, there's a variety of projects which have to do with complicating the modernist narrative and in a way supplementing it and fragmenting it through things like what critical theory, whether it's Frankfurt School critical theory or other types of critical theory, feminism, post-colonialism, different critical discourses that basically become tools through which you can refract what had become a very stultified, solidified discourse of modernism. And then the kind of political questions are basically those of those other discourses, you know, whether it's feminism or whether it's post-colonialism. And there isn't really a substantial discourse which is trying to think, say, you know, let's say politics from within the architectural itself. In fact, the most successful of those discourses are all about reaffirming, hegemony, a kind of, well, you know, it's like history and theory being used to uphold, let's say, the power of American sophistication, the power of architecture as a pragmatic thing. And that all really, in a way, I think, really changes from the 2000s on, which the 2000s begins with a kind of post-critical turn, which is very much about this kind of reassessing practice, and also rejecting critique in a vulgar way. Actually, I think it's through the crisis of 2008 that, in a way, the field becomes repoliticized, and we're still working through what that means, I think, in the field. So this book really comes in at that moment when, in a way, because of the crisis, there's a crisis of legitimacy and also of direction, how you know, in conditions of extreme fluidity and openness, in a way, a crisis. What, you know, how do you make sense of this thing? And there's a lot of different ways. And so the book tries to, in a way, map that problem through this figure of parametricism. And parametricism is a discourse which is really the word is coined by one person, Patrick Schumacher, who's this architect. He's a partner at Zaha Hadid Architects. He's the one who runs the office. Zaha, you've already all heard that she passed away just last week, actually. She was very sad, she was very young. But Patrick has developed this discourse on his own very much. And he really identified parametricism with neoliberal politics. That's an explicit connection that he made. His neoliberalism is really a kind of radical, it's an anarcho-capitalism, it's a kind of Hayekian type of libertarianism. And so he argues for parametricism as a way of designing that can embody and can materialize that ideology. So our book is a reaction against that, and within the book there's different responses to how you could break that down and challenge it, or you know, repurpose it. That's kind of it for me, so maybe we can move up to that.
Yeah, just a couple of short things. The main thing to say is that we invited Patrick Schumacher, although he was, if you like, a target for our critique. We invited him to be part of the project, and he very graciously accepted our invitation and took part very seriously in the conference and gave us a really challenging essay for the book. And the book contains a number of essays which really, on the one hand, it might seem that we approach the problem, largely from a left-wing set of sensibilities, but with an academic sort of attitude or set of methodologies to suspend any kind of moral or partisan political affiliations or prejudices, in order to really interrogate the claims that particularly Patrick makes, but not only Patrick, many others in the architectural history world, architects themselves, architectural critics, who talk about a separation between the architectural and politics. So for example, I don't want to blow our own trumpet here, but we got a really great review of the book a few months ago. But the title was, Does Politics Have a Place in Architecture? And I thought that was incredibly telling, although it was a very supportive review. It was very telling that this is an incredibly prevalent attitude amongst architects in general. On the whole, there is a sort of a character of pragmatism or a kind of assumption or presumption of pragmatism for the industry of architecture. And I suppose both Manuel and I come to the discourse, Manuel is a practicing architect as well, come to the practice and praxis of architecture with a view that these things can't be arbitrarily or willfully separated. And that was really one of the key impetuses for the book. So in some ways, I was thinking about it yesterday. It's interesting that I think the structure of the book is a sort of mixed martial arts assault on the idea of the separation of praxis and theorizing, which is specifically aimed towards parametricism, as it is becoming a very dominant modality in architectural design and beyond in many other areas of design. And its implications for other areas of life, other industries, is massive, because it is fueled, the design processes are fueled by big data, to put it briefly, and algorithmic scripting and so forth. So it has ramifications well beyond the realm of architecture, and many of our contributors employ subject matter that comes from those other realms, which sort of wheel back, if you like, elliptically to analyze architecture.
And in that sense, it's a very useful, I think it's been a very productive discourse to engage with, the challenge, because it does seem to speak to broader patterns in our society, the kind of overwhelming presence that the digital has in our lives. No? And so this is one instance, very concrete instance that we can actually grasp. And regarding the separation between politics and architecture, which is really something that Patrick Schumacher himself very explicitly, very dogmatically says, these things have to remain separate, almost in an authoritarian sense. He kind of pushes that separation. And it's interesting to note that the reason for that is that Patrick has a PhD actually, I think in philosophy, I can't remember if it's economics or philosophy. But his intellectual background is functional sociology. So he builds on a functional sociologist called Niklas Luhmann, a German sociologist, who was himself pupil of Talbot Parsons, who's in a way the founder of this kind of functional sociologist. And the idea of that type of sociology is that society is a kind of vast machine with these functional compartments that connect in very systematic ways, and it's in a way a kind of complex system. But it's a very organicist type of way of thinking about society. And so what we found interesting, I think, is that this type of organicism, technologically infused organicism, is operating not just in parametricism, but I think it's a very typical way of thinking in our societies, particularly as the information society that we live in, the companies that dominate it and the type of ways of thinking around that continue to reproduce those ways of thinking about society themselves. So you know, it's not just an attack on Patrick, I think that's what we're trying to say, you know, it's really a broader question, and I think hopefully a productive way to engage these difficult issues.
Great. So yeah, I'm going to speak for about half an hour, and then Manuel will, and then we'll take the stage. Sure. That's quite loud. The essay that I produced for the book basically focuses on post-Fordist labor models, post-Taylorist management models, and immaterial labor, and the discourses of immaterial labor, and then how that relates to big data, obviously, or data collection, data flows, and data utility in relation to some of the arguments that Patrick makes. My essay in the book begins by talking about how the discipline of design and the practices of design are intrinsically transformed by the innovations of scripting technologies, scripting softwares, and so forth that are deployed in architecture, which is branded as parametricist, and other architecture and design. But what I'm going to talk about today, which has kind of grown out of my interests expressed in that essay, as you can see, is the politics of decay and the decomposition of form as involutive figuration. My practice as a writer tends to kind of range around various different subjects all at once, often seemingly incongruous or disparate, but there are themes that run through it as a body. So sometimes I write about art, sometimes I write about political philosophy in general, sometimes I write about architecture and design, and all sorts of things, you know, curating, curatorial theory, curatorial history and museology, and it's quite a broad practice. So, and often when I give talk, I think of it as a kind of, a sideshow of spinning different plates, keeping different plates spinning on poles, and that's a little bit like the methodology I use sometimes for talks, and that's what I'm going to do today. So I'm going to basically show you the entire PowerPoint first, just to give you a sense of the material that I'm dealing with, or at least I'll show you the images. I've got quite a lot of images. I haven't captioned the images purposefully because, I think as we were saying in our introduction there, neither Manuel nor I want to attack any particular architect, any particular designers. That's really not the issue at stake here. the issue at stake, I think, for both of us is that what we observe in particular examples of architectural design are symptomatic and paradigmatic of wider both symptoms and causes, and actually in the current social and political conditions, what is a symptom and what is a cause, and not always easy to differentiate. In fact, often they are both at the same time. And in some ways, that's what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about politics as a form of decay. And I'll be referring to a brilliant essay by Iranian philosopher Reza Negrestani, who some of you, I'm sure, you know his work, and you may have met him. He visited CalArts fairly recently. I'll show you the pictures. I wanted to start with a caveat, if you like, a warning, or an alibi, an excuse, which is as I talk, I want you to be aware that I'm fully aware of the paradox of entropy, which is that on a cosmic level, literally in the cosmos, what we see as ordered becoming disordered or decaying is actually moving towards absolute order. So of course the universe is cooling down. Excuse me. And as it cools down, theoretically at least, it should result in a... So this is a fairly prosaic representation of a human perspective of entropy, something that's ordered becoming disordered or disintegrated. But in terms of cosmic entropy, universal entropy, the universe is theoretically moving towards a state of absolute cold, absolute zero energy, where every single particle and subatomic particle potentially will be evenly distributed across whatever space the universe can fashion as it expands. And basically, in the end, the universe will be perfectly even, ordered matrix of, simple matrix of grid of subatomic particles. It isn't that at the moment, as we know. It's fairly disordered. But as it cools, that is theoretically how it will be. So I realised that, and in fact the talk is about that, and Reza's essay is actually about that. It's about a realisation that the relationship between order and disorder, or order and chaos, or the absolute and contingency, is never as straightforward as we, our ideologies have had us previously, historically, always, as a human race, had us believe. I'm going to talk about architectural forms, forms in design. And really the idea is to try to show you, if you're not familiar or aware, the prevalence of involuted forms, curvilinear forms, swarming forms in architectural and design practice. You probably recognize some of these. They're very famous examples, many of them. Some diagrams, some interesting objects. Yes, 3D projections by designers and architects. An image of starlings flocking. Then so I'm going to talk about decay and decomposition. I did have an image of the stages of decay of a piglet. It was quite gruesome, to be honest. It was. Somebody advised me not to show it. But it was quite gruesome. Because I don't want this to be sensationalist in any way. There's no need for decay and decomposition to have kind of spectacular dimension. In fact, that's precisely the opposite of what I'm going to argue. Here's I'm sorry, this seems very dark here. It's actually, they're very richly colored images. This is from some Taylor Wood's very well-known video from the 90s, I think. It's a pretty old piece of decaying fruit. And then some models of decomposition, literal, taking a composition and decomposing it into other forms. Another one, very simple forms of decomposition, from regular forms to irregular forms, then fungi, architectural projections and modeling as mirroring. The similarities are striking, I think. I have an argument about decomposition being figuration, where it's ordinarily considered to be a process which is based on a dualistic model of figure and ground, or a move to the abstract, a move towards the away from the field of figuration to the field. So I'll make that argument. And then I talk about forms, and Rez's essay talks about forms coming out of decaying processes. And I might get round to a comparison with artworks, where I talk about discrete forms and the decomposition of forms into the field of the canvas, for example, in the case of Picasso. This very crude genealogy here, from Titian to Manet to Cézanne to Picasso, almost Greenbergian in scope, Jackson Pollock there, of course. But one of the important things I want to talk about is the contrast of involution in architecture, where involuted forms, folded forms, forms that are folding in on themselves, are literally depicted or produced or constructed, whereas in art, certainly in painting, but in contemporary art in general, the involution has been a kind of historiographic involution, in some cases a conceptual involution, which has resulted in amazing things like this, where you have Fragonard on the left and John Curran on the right, largely the same forms. But in between, of course, we know there's a history of modernist experimentation. I had questions like, how do we get from Fragonard to John Curran? There's an involution of a historiographic functionality in art, I think, which is similar to what's happening in design, but it has been manifest in ways that I think are potentially more sophisticated. My argument is basically that most contemporary architecture that looks like this is incredibly simplistic. I'm going to argue that it's kitsch. And I'm going to argue that it is political in its very I don't use the word essence, but in its structural dynamics, it's political. So I'll probably miss this bit out, but I think these are great images. As I talk about kitsch, I think an image like this. Sort of on the edge of kitsch, but one of the both sort of hilariously funny and also incredibly distasteful things about the kind of architecture I'm interested in is that it figures decay and decomposition in a representation which is simplistic and potentially offensive. You would think this is fairly benign in one sense, but I think there's a good argument to be made that there is an aesthetics of decay in a lot of this architecture, which of course is highly constructed, but it's a construction of a decomposition, like a destroyed building, for example. The incredible triviality of Frank Gehry, that's one name I don't mind. I don't mean to be disrespectful to Frank Gehry. He's an incredible architect in many ways, but in terms of the architecture that he's producing in his mature period, it has a kind of immaturity which is profoundly, and I mean that in that it's interesting because it's trivial, it's profoundly trivial. get these kind of fantasies of, you know, incredibly distasteful fantasies of destruction architecture, architecture that depicts destruction. I think you can't see this very well. So it appears that the building is exploding or somehow being destroyed. And so there's a, you know, there are these flights of fancy in architectural practice, mostly at the level of modelling in virtual space, but nonetheless, they exist. So the main thing that I argue is that the way in which architecture, in this case in particular, is political is because it is a symbolic form. And that is the core of the argument. the impetus for this paper that I'm writing, this is a work in progress, but the impetus for putting it together in this way for you was really to ask the question, why are there so many involuted forms in current architectural construction and design? Why are there so many folded and twisted forms? Because so I went through a series of questions asking myself, I don't think the economic argument about efficiency of materials and so forth it holds water. These are not efficient to produce. They're not necessarily efficient buildings. They don't run very efficiently necessarily. There are other forms that could be more efficient. I don't think the phenomenological arguments about affect, I don't think they hold water very well. The idea that there is a kind of a powerful affective physical rhetoric, if you like, which pulls you through the building and pushes you through the building, is kind of intensified and heightened in these kinds of designs. I think that can be equally powerful with rectilinear forms, orthogonal forms, other geometric forms. It's not unique or special to these kinds of smooth, differential radiated forms. And especially the involuted form. The question is, why is the involuted form so popular? And I think my argument is that it is, it's not just a fashion. It is a fashion, but it's not just a fashion. It's because symbolically the involuted form has a particular kind of political currency, a particular kind of ideological currency, which I think is very instructive of certain conditions of the political today in a society that would build these forms. So the other question, of course, is then, not just why are these flowing forms so popular, why are the involuted forms so popular, but how are they different to swarming forms, which are the other, of course, the other big fashion, if you like, or let's say popular motif in architectural practice and in the sort of far reaches of architectural experimentation. And I think the swarm, I argued that the swarm is a significantly different symbolic form. It's of course a significantly different ontological form, but functionally the swarm form is produced in largely the same structural dynamic way, or with the same structural dynamics as the curvilinear differential involuted form. So how are they different? How are they symbolically different and different in their aesthetic functionality, and then what is the politics of that type of swarming design as a mechanism, as a motif?
Excuse me.
So the first thing to say, as I mentioned briefly before, is that the flowing architectural form, if contrasted with, you know, the great buildings of the modernist tradition or modernist heritage, and the great architectural edifices of previous epochs, and I suppose the example I was thinking of really was, you know, the height of the sort of liberal a modern but liberal Europe, where you have museum buildings, for example, which delineate space very clearly. They delineate the functionality of space very clearly. Museums are special cases. 18th and 19th century museums are very special cases in delineating the symbolic and functional use of space. They of course separate public and private space, or different types of public space, with walls, that's obvious, but galleries and museums are special from that period, because they have a number of doorways, all 18th and 19th century museum buildings have at least four, often six, sometimes eight doorways that you have to go through from the street until you see some art. And there's something incredibly, of course it's incredibly important why that is the case, which is to symbolize that there is a ritualistic, processional movement that you make as you enter the gallery. Often you go upstairs, of course, there's a flight of stairs outside and then maybe a flight of stairs inside. All these basically ancient Greek, Persian, and Roman tropes of symbolic ascension, the literal ascension, and so forth, anointment by moving through doors, transformation of mood and so forth, transformation of your spiritual and psychic state, if you like. But with the curvilinear involuted building, the point at which, for example, public space, the street owned, the civic space, where that becomes the private space of the corporation, for example, which owns the building and owns the part of the land, is of course intentionally blurred. It's a very simple argument to make. It's blurred. You don't know when you're actually in the building, even. You can't definitively say, I'm going into the building now. Something like this by Zardin's office. When are you inside that volume in the middle slide? When are you inside? You're never actually inside, and you're never actually outside. It's both. And particularly, of course, the involuted form, the truly involuted form, such as the Möbius strip. These forms based on Möbius strip, they literally have no inside or outside. They have no top and bottom, as I'm sure you know. These ones at the bottom are just amazing kind of baroque convolutions of this involuted form. I think they're terrific, but they're incredibly popular in design, because they're quite easy to make with software. Klein bottle down and a shell form, from shellfish. But this argument of the de-delineation of the functionality of space is just one quite simple but nonetheless complex idea for which architecture is responsible and does take responsibility. But again, I don't think it quite answers the question why have involuted forms in particular being so popular. The canopy, for example, does a similar sort of job to blur the distinction between inside and outside. Also, there are modernist buildings which do so too. The Peter and Alison Smithson, famous modernist architects, mostly producing work in the mid-60s, 1960s, you know, their ground floor spaces and the towers they produced, I used to work in one, the Economist building in St. James's in central London, just near Prince Charles's house, and Piccadilly and the Royal Academy. That used to have essentially a kind of open ground floor. So again, you were never sort of necessarily inside or outside until you got into the lift shaft, the elevator shaft, into an elevator, and then you were inside. So, you know, that argument too doesn't necessarily hold water as to why the involuted form is so popular. Even the most ardent neoliberal who would want to blur public and private space, who might make the argument that, well, you know, I'm a genuine believer in neoliberal economic and politics and governmentality. I want to blur, you know, I don't want anyone to know whether they're in public space or private space, because that's how you control the population efficiently, through a kind of terror and uncertainty. I'm being schematic here, of course. Even, you know, that argument doesn't hold sway as to why these buildings, these types of forms, these motifs are so popular. And so I came to a kind of tacit conclusion, a provisional conclusion, that it is symbolic. It has to be symbolic, and as such, it has to be, you know, the symbolic is always political. So, you know, the simple idea, the simple dichotomy of field or ground and figure in decay, the merging of figure and ground in decay is too simplistic an idea, too simplistic an understanding of what decay is, to really address this question of what the functionality of these types of buildings are. But also, I think it, the involuted forms. But I think it also gives us a really interesting way of thinking about what politics is, or what the structural functionality and modality of politics can be, beyond the conservation of epistemological habits. That's really the thing that I'm driving at. You know, our understanding of knowledge, our understanding of categories, how we can, if we're willing to abandon the illusion of certainty in certain philosophical habits that we have as a society, we can embrace what parametricism offers, or we can embrace what the technologies offer, to really produce a different kind of politics. And I'll talk about why in a moment. So this, you know, these depictions of decomposition as decay, or decay as decomposition, where a discrete form is essentially blurring with a field or a ground, is one way to think about what decomposition is, or what decay is. But it's really too simplistic, and it really is the basis of most ideologies that exist or have existed. So obviously, for time's sake, I'm having to be incredibly schematic, and it's really, you know, this is really just a peek into the subjects that I'm dealing with in the essay that I'm writing. So what I want to do is really, I suppose these two slides illustrate it best. You know, here we have an image of a fairly well-resolved portrait of a human face decomposing or decaying, literally decomposing into the field of the photograph, the figure on the ground, the image, the subject, and the object becoming fused and broken down into one another, dissolved into one another. But the fact of the matter is, of course, we know, you know, using a biological example, that This diagram is rather nice here. We have organic debris at the bottom rotting. Bacteria, of course, aiding that decomposition, but even the replication and reproduction of the bacteria is a generative process. So there's a degenerative process leading to a generative process, and you know, fungi the same. And then, of course, other animals come along and eat those forms and reproduce their form, and then you know, more complex organisms and animals come along and so forth, etc., etc. So the decomposition as figuration itself, that is not necessarily cyclical. That's the other important thing to really stress at this point. This is not an argument for cyclicality, which would be just banal, but it's an argument about the ontological nature of politics. What is politics is really the question. So an inspiration for the analysis for the essay that I'm writing is really comes from Iranian philosopher and engineer Reza Negrestani, who wrote this essay Undercover Softness: An Introduction to the Architecture and Politics of Decay in 2010. And it's an essay which it basically makes a key point, which is that decay is the complicity or the complicity and collective action of what he calls extensivities and intensivities. So it's actually an essay about chemistry and mathematics, a relationship between chemistry and mathematics, and he builds a model of what politics is, an ontological schema of politics, as decay and decomposition through chemistry and mathematics, and the chemistry and mathesis of decay. And the key point that he makes is that to get away from this binary of subject and object, figure and ground, and decomposition as the destruction of a discrete figure into a less defined ground, you have to employ an understanding of politics as and an understanding of politics as a form of decay in which extensivities, that is what is external to a being, to an entity, is only such because of its intensivities, which are what make it possible. What the constituent parts that make the extensivity possible are its intensivities, and they themselves are an infinitely nested series of ever smaller relationships, dynamic relationships. So that which is an intensivity of a larger extensivity has intensivities of its own, which makes it also an extensivity, and so on and so on. And in decay, what happens is that the intensivities become explicit as the extensivity decomposes, is broken down. But this is an infinite process, but it's also an asymptotic process, which is that it is a process which tends towards zero, but it never reaches zero. And also the relationship time and space, because of course this is a process of contingency. This is a process of change. It's a process of contingency, and in contingency, within these processes of contingency, the relationship of time and space is asymptotic also, but it's very specifically delineated by Negrestani to show that time has an incredibly powerful effect on space to fold it and to compress it, and equally space has this rather strange effect on time, where it produces a third form of time. But I'm not going to get into that right now. There are ordinarily two forms of time, chronic time and chaotic time. Chronic time is the quantitative time, measurable time, quantitatively measurable time, and chaotic time is the quality of time, the quality of the experience of time in change. One is constant, one is a constant, and the other is subject to variable rates of change. So I won't get into that, that's far too far. And also I've been talking for 29 minutes now, so I might stop in a minute. Anyway, I thought I'd just, I'm probably just going to stop at this quote actually, because this is the very last few lines of the essay. And it really sums up the key impetus for Negrestani writing this essay, where he says, it's not that earthly thought is the site of decay from which we must ascend to the fresh air, but that the calculus of decay constitutes the ecology of our interiorized worlds. Whether built on the desolate surface of the earth or in the fresh air of a beyond. The calculus of decay has its own problems, ideas and solutions. To politicize, philosophize, scheme or take action without such calculus is tantamount to calculating outside of this world. An outside that does not suggest the great abyssal outdoors, but instead the sealed enclosures of pure entelechy, whose immutable horizon does not welcome ecological change in direction whatsoever. So in this quote he's saying, politics, philosophy, action or planning must engage. They must engage with what exists. They must, or else they're just fantasy. They're just even worse than fantasy. They are useless. Entelechic, completely hermetically sealed. They're useless to change. They won't, unless these forms of human endeavor engage with what is actually there. There is no point in doing those things. So, but he gives plenty of caveats throughout the essay, in that this, and he does here, of course, too, that politics is a form of decay because, and it must be thought of as a form of decay, because of this, because of the nature of what has been made explicit in our epoch today, from around the 1950s with the burgeoning of different prototypical forms of neoliberal governance, but also with the decomposition and decay of liberal institutions, the liberal edifices embodied by truth, beauty, justice, egality, fraternity, whatever the other one is, liberty. these edifices are literally decomposing under neoliberal governance, under the kind of economico-political milieu, which is fueled by the mechanisms of capitalism, obviously, but not as a result of capitalism intrinsically. I would argue they're very separate things, but the historical contingency that they exist at the same time has meant that they have exacerbated and accelerated each other. And the argument Negrestani is making is that in order to take on a form of politics, well, a cryptographic form of politics like that, in fact, a sort of pseudo-politics like neoliberalism, it's simply no good to appeal to philosophical, epistemological, political habits such as they are in the liberal tradition, for example, based on these dyadic forms of, you know, for example, figure and ground. And instead, there's a more stringent form of politics, or a more stringent understanding of politics, in which, whose understanding brings forth far more efficacious tools to deal with what is effectively, you know, what appears to be a kind of stasis. And I'm not really talking about the Fukuyama and end of history kind of narratives, but the you know, the more profound questions of our inability to think the end of capitalism, for example, you know, Zizek's famous multiple quotes that we can and we frequently do envisage the end of the human race, or the end of civilization, or the end of the, you know, the planet, or the end of the universe, but we cannot, it seemingly can't think the end of capitalism. We can't think beyond the horizons of capitalism. And the fantastic thing about Reza's essay is that by talking about these nested, simultaneously extensive and intensive entities, the nested forms, and the dynamic decomposing functionality between them, he is able to introduce the concept of the horizon in a productive way. The concept of the limit, the concept of the end, the concept of a definition, but through the calculus of dynamic, differentiated, differential forms, by involving what he calls convoluted forms, and I have a number of quotes about convolution, which are absolutely crucial to understanding the nested nature of this dynamic process of decay, which is political, you know, the political. And it's in convolution, which no doubt is twisted. He talks about the twisted line of the convoluted form, but it is not involuted. So there's a huge difference between a fractal, for example. A fractal is a convoluted form, but it is not an involuted form. An involuted form has to be folded in on itself. And so, for example, Fragonard to Curran shows that the contemporary art world, or the art world in general, or human art production, shows itself to be involuted. And the reason it's involuted is because it's based on a very, very coherent ideology, which essentially, at its core, has a massive vacuum, and that is liberalism. Liberalism at its core, this is how it works. It has a huge vacuum at the middle. It has huge aporia, philosophical aporia, at its core. And the involution as a symbolic form shows us that, in that we can go from Fragonard through modernism to John Curran, producing essentially the same thing, basically the same material forms produced. I believe the symbolic function of the involuted form in architecture and design equally shows that, you know, these buildings are simply symbolic reproductions, representations of this literally vacuous core of the most of the fundaments of the institutions and edifices of the ideology which we still live within, even though, of course, neoliberals would argue otherwise, socialists would argue otherwise. Maybe I'll leave it there.
About optimization, but in a different way. So I'll be talking about ontology, but through the figure of historical ontology, which is a term coined. And this is also what we wanted to do, is present a little bit different methodologies, since this is a kind of learning environment, so we can all think together, how do these work? I'm currently doing a PhD in architectural history and theory, so I work really historically. And it's impossible to work historically without working theoretically. But I'm going to show you a history. And that history is the history of the swarm. In fact, the digital swarm. It's really interesting, the kind of resonances. And I should say, this work is actually the work that is present in my essay in the book. So if you're interested, you can read that essay. But I'll be giving a little bit more context and also evidence, historical evidence. So this is the, I mean, you can see, right, this is the image that is underneath, literally underneath the cover of our book. It's an image that Patrick Schumacher from Zaha Hadid Architects gave us very kindly, so thank you to them again, of a swarm. And so, like Matthew has very eloquently recounted, the swarm has become this kind of incredibly paradigmatic image and also function of our societies, and it's really quite interesting to see how the history of the swarm as an image is tied to the histories of digitalization, which are intrinsically political. And a little bit this talk, what it's trying to do is to theorize or to historicize the aesthetic of the swarm, in fact, as an entirely geopolitical thing. A lot of the initial interest for me in the swarm comes from the fact that the ideology that we've been discussing today, that is so well represented by parametricism, is at its core a kind of naturalism, a very vulgar type of naturalism, yeah, a kind of organicism, like showing organic forms. It's a type of kitsch, like Matthew said. But it's, why it's so effective is that it really is a symbolic, I'd say, allusion, and in a way a tribute to a type of metaphysics which is that of a vitalist type of capitalism. It's a capitalism that is animated, that it has its own ghost, basically, and that ghost is a kind of ideology. So the way that that ghost makes its appearance, and you know, previous figurations of that ghost, the most famous one is the invisible hand, right? That's the classic. And the invisible hand today appears like that. The idea of the free, unregulated market, the self-regulating market, has its most dynamic and its most spectacular figuration in the image of the swarm. So that, I think that's a lot why we keep returning to this, because it really is working that way. Now I found, just to tell you a little bit what the argument is in brief, if you historicize this, you come again and again actually to the figure of the child, of the creative, unmediated, expressive child. That's actually what's underneath this, and I'll show you how. It's also really interesting that the digital swarm in architecture emerges in the early 90s, and I think that's not a coincidence that it's really entwined with the triumphant emergence of capitalism after the fall of the wall. Those two things really go together, this triumphant image and its use within architecture. And that has also the parallel history of the development of computation in architecture. And again, the development of computation and the development of swarms have a very concrete history that we're going to look at now. And they're entirely tied together. So I'll be focusing on the swarm as a type of rationality. And so by trying to historicize it, I'm looking at the technology, the use of the swarm, and the types of rationalities that work in a way, in a kind of in a scientific sense, but also in a type of the ways of thinking, the epistemologies and the ideologies that constitute those rationalities. So I'll argue that the swarm, the digit swarm, needs to be understood as a type of naturalism, that it provides a diagram of decentralized but coordinated action, so that's very key. And in, thus it's a kind of political phenomenology of vitalism and deregulation that is configured in appearance, but only in appearance, in purely aesthetic forms and terms. That's a plan of Turkey, I believe it's in Istanbul, of Zaha Hadid Architects. This is actually an image taken from the book. It's from Patrick Schumacher's essay in the book. So here you have a kind of illustration of how the swarm interfaces an existing urbanism in this particular example. I mean, we saw many more with Matthew's presentation. But what's important is that it's tied to a reaction against the modernist tradition, which is all about central planning. So early modernism, and really the apex of that, the zenith of that is Soviet constructivism, you know, and the Soviet experiment of total planning. And that's in a way the absolute monster, the absolute other that neoliberalism is constantly negating. And there's good reasons for that, but it's also an incredibly simplistic dichotomy. That's a little bit what I want to talk about. And in architecture, there's an illustrious history of trying to work against the plan and against the idea of central planning, and even against the idea of architects. Why should there be an architect? You know, architecture is a natural thing. Dwelling is a natural thing that everybody does around the world. All cultures do it. So there's these, just showing you some books from within the architectural canon that theorize modes of urbanism and architecture that don't require centralized planning. One of these is Architecture Without Architects, a short introduction to non-pedigreed architecture from 64 by Bernard Rudofsky. And so the image on your right is Marrakesh. Another two very, very classic examples, The Death and Life of Great American Cities. Maybe some of you have read that book, I don't know, it's by Jane Jacobs, very passionate rebuke of the type of technocratic planning that was taken over New York around the 50s. And then obviously, super famous Rem Koolhaas' Delirious New York, which is a different, a much more intelligent reaction against the idea of planning, in the sense of a celebration of, in a way, the entropic nature of capital, a celebration of its absolute congestion, that's the word he uses. So, what I propose to do is to deconstruct the opposition between centralized planning and decentralized action, which is in a way structuring the way that we think about these things, by historicizing the first digital simulation of a swarm. That can be dated exactly to 1987, which is the date that the first computer digital simulation of a swarm was published by a computer scientist. We'll get into that history. It was published in an article called Flocks, Herds, and Schools, a distributed behavioral model in a computer graphics magazine, a incredibly geeky niche magazine. But it turns out that this study had enormous consequences for a variety of fields, from logistics to biological research, to entertainment industry, to architecture as well. And so, before I get into the actual history of it, which is its own thing, I wanted to tell you how the kind of issues that I have while I think about this, the methodological questions that are in the background. And one of them is the question of scale that I think is super central also to the way Matthew was speaking. The difficulty in thinking with scale, and scale is a modernist rubric and a modernist perspective. So at the same time, I think precisely what the digital allows us to do is to work multidimensionally much more, and to think multidimensionally much more. So that's that one question. The other one is, what is the interface between ideology and intellectual technology, which I think is also very much at the core of what Matthew was talking about between intensive and extensive. And so in a way we've inherited these rubrics of critical thinking, really. And a lot of this materialist or neo-materialist theory is trying to see how, you know, what survives after you subject these very important questions, you know, of whether it's the idea of rationality or the idea of ideology, what survives when you begin to think more materially. So these issues are for me implicit, and the fact that we're thinking about them can't really be distinguished from the fact that there's a history to them. And so I'm going to tell you to historicize them a little bit. And in so doing, I hope to show that the very large, from geopolitics to national budgets, is intimately tied to the very small, whether we talk about human subjectivity or the education of children. And my argument would be that those kind of splits are integral to a crisis at the heart of liberalism in the post-war period, which is anxiously trying to found itself and ground itself in a more positive, systemic, and technocratic foundation. So it's a little bit, in a way, the knowledge that these things are unhinged, and the need for in many ways, to do with the American Empire, I think, it has a lot to do with the Cold War, to build a kind of discourse that is can be discussed in very modernist and rationalistic terms. I will try to argue that the development of, in a way, neoclassical economics, in particular rational choice theory, which was developed down the road in Rand Corporation in Santa Monica, it's really crucial to this type of thinking. And in particular, I use the term microeconomic devices, which is a mixture between a sociologist, Michel Calon, and has been taken up by the anthropologist Stephen Collier recently. I find the theme of the microeconomic device as a really productive category. And so the argument is that the microeconomic devices are to be understood as the constitutive metaphysical molecules, let's say, of Adam Smith's invisible hand as they take shape in material terms since the post-war period, since the end of the Second World War. So that's these are images from that first article from 1987. The person who wrote that article, Craig Reynolds, was a computer engineer and a graduate from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology's Architecture Machine Group, which was a program founded in the 60s by Nicholas Negroponte, also an architect. And Craig Reynolds was mentored by Negroponte, who will come back in this story that I'm going to tell you. So the 1987 article had these amazing images. And more amazing than the images was the simplicity of the argument. It was beautiful. He theorized that you could produce swarm dynamics digitally by an incredibly simple mechanism. And that's important because actually scientists and artists had been trying to replicate swarm dynamics artificially for centuries, really for 100 years now. So you can imagine like this type of 19th century photography of organic processes, that type of way of thinking of wanting to capture the dynamic process of organic movement had been impossible to really theorize until 1987. So he said, you only need an agent-based modeling program, and you need these three rules. And if you get these three rules to work together, you get a swarm formation. So the three rules: keep an equal distance from everyone around you, don't change speed too fast, and avoid stationary objects. And so if you do that, you get the apparently automatic, synchronized, decentralized, and emergent behavior of swarms. Here you have another few more images from Reinhold's experiment. So, you know, one of those behaviors is that you could, that the swarm would automatically avoid objects. So it would be moving and it would divide into two and come back together. What was striking about the simulation was that these such simple rules could, in a way, reproduce the behaviors that looked unplanned and intentional, and even though it was a computer doing it. And as he put it, the aggregate motion that we intuitively recognize as flocking or schooling or herding depends upon a limited localized view of the world. So rich the statement. So it's interesting because, you know, I think that you can't really read this statement without considering it symbolically, and yet it's a totally technical statement, and I think that's what's fascinating. I think that's what's really amazing about neoliberal politics, is the fact that it's actually so technical and yet so ideological. These technical considerations were crucial elements in a developing epistemology of emergence and self-organization in the 1980s. You know, tropes that are really at the root of so much of the science that surrounds us today, and also the culture. It became really popular, analysis of the swarm, even to the point that sociologists were now quoting it. This is a text from 1997. The rules do not in themselves predict flock behavior. The exact form of the structure, the flock, is neither entirely random nor predictable. And so in a way you have social scientists now trying to understand how do you describe this thing that has no edges and is emergent. Crucial to this definition of emergence in complex system is the impossibility to accurately determine or predict the final outcome of the model, because the final outcome or the final result or its state at any point depends on states and variables that are themselves dependent on the iterative evolution of the model. No? So that what the computer is doing is recalculating the position of each one of those points in the system. And you can't really calculate it in advance, because the next calculation depends always on the preceding one. So thus the model seemed to prove, and almost mechanically to prove, the impossibility of coordinated complex social action by genetic design, in a way. And I read this as another nail in the coffin of coordinated planning and politics. And so Reinhold goes on to work for Hollywood, and he wins an Oscar in the late 90s for developing crowds for the movie. So a lot of, for example, I think the Batman, remember the first Batman, there was like a lot of bats and things like that, so that was him. So you know, this simple geeky swarm thing becomes quite big. So now I'm going to go back. When you historicize this model, it gets more interesting, more complex. Reinhold's simulation program was in fact based on Logo. Logo is a computer program, an early Lisp programming program developed by a scientist from MIT as well, which was a geometry program. It was a drawing program, basically. It's one of the first CAD programs, actually. In fact, even a lot of the scripts that are used in CAD programs today come from Logo directly. Now there's all these lineages that you can follow. And it was developed at the end of the 60s by this guy, Seymour Papert, who was a very interesting character. So he was working at the Artificial Intelligence Lab at the MIT. And he was a mathematician. And he had himself an interesting background. So he had a PhD in mathematics, but he also had a PhD in developmental psychology. And before joining MIT, he had been collaborating with Jean Piaget, one of the big figures of 20th century developmental psychology. He had been working with him at the University of Geneva. Papert worked at the AI lab, which was co-founded by Marvin Minsky. And the lab, as probably a lot of you know, is one of the central nodes in the military industrial complex. And it's received all of its funding pretty much from ARPA, which was the precursor to DARPA, the Advanced Research Project Agency, which was set up in 58 by Eisenhower. So Logo was born with this weird connection. You know? On the one hand, this radical mathematical genius working on developmental psychology, and with a very countercultural sensibility around the liberation of children, and at the same time, basically the military-industrial complex and the search for tools for the development of computing very much along the lines of gaining capacities, no, in the context of the Cold War. So these educational experiments revolutionized learning, the experiments that emerged from Logo, and they were premised on ideas of creativity. They were always, at the same time, intrinsically tied to developments in cybernetics and in computing. So in a way, it's an interesting, the reason I'm interested in this history is because there's a really good case study of the historical connection between discourses of creativity and technology that today seem to be so, you know, in a way, inescapable. So the Logo Revolution promised to allow children to learn mathematics by doing rather than by drill and practice. So Papert was inspired very much by a kind of pragmatist philosophy. And so it was very novel and it was very progressive to be thinking about ways of teaching that were not about brute memorization or, you know, authoritarian types of modes of learning. So this was a kind of way of learning that was fun. As he said, the flavor of turtle geometry can be tasted by comparing typical descriptions of a geometric figure, say a circle, in turtle geometry, which is the language of Logo, the artificial language of Logo, and in Cartesian geometry. And so there you have, in a kind of graphic sense, you know, one of them is an equation and the other one is a simple set of instructions. To circle, forward one, right one, circle, end. And then you can repeat it if you want. And so in order to get the children conscious of mathematics, the tool was basically for them to become themselves a tool, for them to become a vector. So the body becomes a vector. That in order to get children to become conscious of the embodied mathematical knowledge that they already had, in a way, it was just a question of showing them that they already had that knowledge. They could do this by using a machine that would help them to, in a way, transfer their subjectivity and their position, their heading, and their magnitude, really like a vector, by this cybernetic thing called a turtle. And the turtle is just because it was kind of semi-domed shaped. A machine which had some wheels and a pen, and you had a console that you could basically input the parameters of the program so that you would tell it to move 20 inches that way, then do a 90 degree turn, and turn that, and at the same time it would draw, as it moved, it would draw on the floor. So it was a very fun, it was a game type of environment. As Papert described it, since learning to control the turtle is like learning to speak a language, it mobilizes the child's expertise and pleasure in speaking. Since it is like being command, it mobilizes the child's expertise and pleasure in commanding. To make the turtle trace a square, you walk in a square yourself and describe what you're doing in turtle talk. And so working with the turtle mobilizes the child's expertise and pleasure in motion. It draws on the child's well-established knowledge of body geometry as a starting point for the development of bridges into formal geometry. Teaching the computer how to think, Papert noted, children embark on an exploration about how they themselves think. The experience can be heady. Thinking about thinking turns the child into an epistemologist, an experience not even shared by most adults. This is like as geeky and countercultural as you can get. So it was an exciting idea that you could actually, in a way, teach children to think about thinking. It's very ambitious. So this Logo project was conceived as a way for the child to become personally, and this is again Papert, personally, intellectually, and emotionally involved, thereby gaining a greater and more articulate mastery of the world, a sense of the power of applied knowledge, and a self-confidently realistic image of himself as an intellectual agent. And so I find it quite interesting. It's a kind of history of creativity and ideas of autonomy that is highly technocratic and at the same time quite revolutionary. It's complicated. So to me, I think that, you know, there's some interesting resonances there about a kind of a kind of contradiction in a way between the avowed objectives of this techno-pedagogy. The avowed objectives are in a sense liberal. They have to do with the decaying functions of liberalism mentioned by Matthew regarding liberty and autonomy, individuality, freedom. And at the same time, you have to constantly remember that this is part of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology program funded by this military-industrial complex in the search of modes of applied knowledge for increasing technocratic control. And so those two things are happening at once in this child. So it's quite interesting. I think it's interesting to me because I think we've returned there very much today, you know, in the injunctions to creativity that and to self-entrepreneurialize that we receive every single day. You know? But staying in the 70s, these are some kids playing with the machines of the turtles. In order to test the logo program and its complex technological apparatuses, including cybernetic turtles and computers, the logo team began deploying their project across schools around the US and around the world. In fact, I myself did logo geometry in school. I don't know if probably more people in the audience have. Nobody in the audience. You did set it. Okay, we have a few people. So I hope that you sympathize with this type of material. Yeah, it's really interesting. It was a thing. It's still a thing, in fact. Each course with the children was an opportunity to try out different iterations of Turtle Robots, logo program versions, and also pedagogical tactics, exercises, and techniques. Can you read that? Yeah, kind of. The fieldwork experiments became more systematic and complex as the team developed new programs and these exercises and tools. And all this accumulated socio-technical data was transcribed into a series of official reports that were published by the AI lab, the MIT AI lab. These reports were themselves the basis for multiple National Science Foundation and ARPA applications for funding that the MIT group, the logo group, and the AI lab applied to successfully pretty much every year throughout the 70s. So all of this stuff that's happening in the classrooms gets fed into these reports, and the reports become basically the deliverable to get the money from these national programs. This is another report showing tabulations of performance by the children. It's very interesting. So indeed, following the various methods of accounting for the child's creativity and performativity with the logo assemblage in these reports, I would say that Papert's transcriptions of these technopedagogical processes into statements and tabulations of value are a way of closing off, in the sense of looping back, a cybernetic apparatus of subjectivization that is at once geopolitical and liberal. These tabulations bureaucratize what was seen as an experiment in radical autonomy and appear to inaugurate a new era of measurable and thus accountable techno-creativity, so vital to the operations of the information society. So there's a sense in which these early tabulations of this behavior that is otherwise, you know, completely banal from the children, they're prototyping a way of measuring something like creativity. It's very important as you're moving. The 70s is a decade of post-industrialization. No? So I think this is also interesting in how it prefigures that that later development. In very direct terms, the tabulations also fulfill a need for results according to funding applications. In fact, this funding requirement greatly influenced the direction of the logo group, as well as other work being conducted by the AI lab. Among other things, the funders from DARPA, the National Science Foundation, and the Office for Naval Research expected work with a clearly normative dimension, as well as the research that would connect different strands of the academic and military interests of the time. In the logo group efforts, reports, we see these researchers constantly speculating about potentials suggested by these methods and the tools they are exploring. And that's a lot what these reports are about. It's just like, well, you know, now we tried this, but it could be that, and we could actually extend it in this direction. It's very speculative, it's very creative. Among these speculations, one really caught my eye. And as, by the way, these reports are all online as part of the MIT archive, so it's a really fun read. Among these, among these reports, there was this one speculation which was about grouping virtual turtles programmed according to geometric or other ends in order to model biological formations and their evolution. This is in 1971. Thus connecting the artificial intelligence work on computing with Papert's own experimental projects on cybernetic psychology. And so you have, in effect, in this report, really a direct, in a way, template for the 1987 Swarm model, except for it's in this kind of more prosaic, more speculative prose. But what's interesting to me is that this question of biological aggregation is mirrored in many different dimensions of MIT at the time. The question of aggregation, whether it's biological or disciplinary, because the military-industrial complex is premised on interdisciplinarity, you know, it's military, industrial, and academic in this sense. So, in a way, the notion of interdisciplinarity, which I think is an interesting counterbalance to the question of in a way, evolution or entropy of this kind of need of trying to find a foundation by connecting things. It's happening in different ways. One of the ways is the ways that different institutes at MIT are coming together. And so the AI lab is one such example. You know, it's an AI lab that comes together. I think it's the research and laboratory and electronics and a few other departments coming together to form it. One of the other ones is the Architecture Machine Group, which again is part of the AI lab and part of the architecture school. The Architecture Machine Group, in fact, and Nicholas Negroponte, who founded it and ran it, was at the heart of one of the big consolidation programs happening there, which was the founding of the Media Lab, which was founded in the 80s, but it began in the 70s. And it was spearheaded by Nicholas Negroponte, who is the one on the left there, in front of the experiment. The Architecture Machine Group explicitly tried to articulate these connections between cybernetics, computing, and architecture. And it's the program that Craig Reynolds was a graduate from. The Media Lab represents the combination of this general dynamic of disciplinary convergence at MIT, or aggregation at MIT, and the School of Architecture and Planning, the Center for Advanced Visual Studies, and the AI Lab all came together in this one building. It was designed by Ian Pei and opened in 1985. Among the aggregations that are happening through that institutional aggregation is also changing funding patterns. And so what you see are a lot of experiments to do with aggregation. This one is one on called Seek, that was published, that was exhibited at the Jewish Museum in New York in 1970, on a famous exhibition called Software. And in it, there's this quite interesting experiment, which is basically these aluminum blocks that get replaced according to the patterns that are created by the movement of these gerbils that are moving around. And so each time that the kind of mound decomposes, you can see there that there's this kind of like machine that is basically, it's a camera, and it picks up the block and puts it in the place that the gerbil left it. And so it's this kind of organicist type of architecture. There was a whole load of problems with the exhibit that it didn't really work correctly, that the gerbils were being kind of hurt by the blocks. And, anyway, the technocratic planning in a decentralized way, and it's very, very interesting because, of course, the authority lies with the cybernetic mechanism, it doesn't lie with any particular human figure. So as Negroponte would say, the design of the city can start to reflect every single inhabitant, his needs and desires, with no need for middlemen, such as architects or politicians. And so what's interesting is that this is just happening at the moment, in that now we move to the late 70s and early 80s, where, in a way, the insecurity, the national insecurities change from, or in a way, become complexified by two things. One is defunding of a lot of the programs that were funding the military-industrial complex. And another one is a shift to the question of education as a primary focus of in a way, insecurity, and tied to the Reagan administration coming to power. In 1983, the administration publishes this report called A Nation at Risk. This is the first line of the report. Our nation is at risk. Our once unchallenged preeminence in commerce, industry, science, and technological innovation is being overtaken by competitors throughout the world. What was unimaginable a generation ago has begun to occur. Others are matching our and surpassing our educational attainments. If an unfriendly foreign power had attempted to impose on America the mediocre educational performance that exists today, we might well have viewed it as an act of war. We have, in effect, been committing an act of unthinking unilateral educational disarmament. And so it's in this context that the Media Lab is being born. And by being born, I mean becoming aggregated with from different institutes. And it's searching for funding. Negroponte is out doing his fundraising. No more money is coming in monolithic ways as it used to from these discrete sources from within the federal government. And so he's trying to find funding from other places. And he sees the future really clearly. This is quite amazing. This is his slide from 79. And he says, what the Media Lab is going to do is going to get on the wave of what's going to happen. And what's going to happen is this: the broadcast motion picture industry, the print publishing industry, and the computer industry are converging, and they're going to converge. In fact, in the year 2000, it's going to be indistinguishable. And this is happening in the early 80s at the level of media companies buying each other out and consolidating and telecommunications companies. So it's, in a way, it's a moment, it's an interesting moment of deregulation that results, in fact, in a much more monopolized type of capitalism, which is interesting because it's the opposite. Rhetorically, the neoliberal doctrine is precisely the opposite. So what happens is that the Media Lab gets its funding from all of these corporate sponsors instead of government. This is Stuart Brand, who's obviously another important figure in the background of all this. Stuart Brand, the editor of the Whole Earth Catalog, who then becomes this kind of techno-capitalist, new capitalist figure. He wrote a book about the Media Lab in 87 called Inventing the Future of MIT. Nobody political has paid the slightest bit of attention to Negroponte or the Media Lab. Who's lined up the door are the business studs. And so he gives this this huge, huge list of all these big companies, including some government ones. 100 sponsors, a few of them government, most of them corporate. And so what I find really interesting about this this shift, and so by this point, Papert is continuing his experiments in schools. It's all going in the background. But the Media Lab is becoming more and more important. It's taking the center stage. In a way, it's actualizing the promises that the Logo program put in place. And this is a description of Negroponte himself, of the funding applications to all these corporations. You can call a company's bluff. You can say, you have two choices. You want to fund something for $300,000 a year? We'll give you an exclusive on that, and we won't show it to anybody else. But when you come to the lab, we're going to put blinders on you and take you up to the little room and show you the work we're doing for you, and then we'll march you right out of the building again. There happens to be $6 million of other stuff going on in the building, but you're not going to get to see any of it. Or you can tell them, give us the same $300,000, we'll give you complete access to the full $6 million package, and all you have to do is let us show other people what we're doing for you. Which would you prefer? Everybody so far has said they prefer access to the full package. And so what's really interesting, this is Negroponte at TED Talk. And so what's really interesting is this shift, the media shift that happens from funding applications predicated on governmental reports to a mode of funding that is really predicated on spectacularization of research. And that is what TED Talks are, basically. And Nicholas Negroponte is a kind of foundational figure in that whole discourse. So this is Stuart Brand, just to finish off, explaining how why it is that these companies submit themselves to, in a way, the spectacularized form of competitive research. How can you peer 10 years along a technological trend line that might devour or starve your present cash cows? How can you explore the crossover technologies where entire new businesses are being born without becoming one of the stillborn? You read in the Wall Street Journal or the Boston Globe how the former industrial backwater, Massachusetts, is booming, with unemployment down 3.6% and a state budget surplus, and it's all being attributed to MIT. Then Negroponte shows up keynoting somewhere with video demos of MIT researchers test piloting information technologies at the edge of the possible, flying in formation around a pattern vague and shifting but emergent, hypnotic, and you buy them. And so that takes us full circle, really. The figure that unlocks the funding is this one. And that happens through no longer through federal funding application only, but through a media landscape that is built upon a kind of competitive model of creativity, which is itself funded on the idea of creativity at the level of the self-entrepreneurialized individual, which when self-aggregated according to capitalist competition, becomes a sort of formation. So what I think is very interesting is how these two scales are basically nested one within the other, and it's a reproductive cycle that we keep replaying over and over and over again. So we should stop, and we should start to think, what does centralized planning look like in the 21st century? Thanks.
Well, first of all, thank you guys very much. This is something I think about a lot, and it was kind of inspired by the conference that you guys did a couple of years ago. In a very pragmatic sense, I see what a lot of designers are doing, parametricism, as kind of opening up one pathway, perhaps out of neoliberalism, without being fully out of capitalism. And in the other sense, I see that we have more people than ever, you know, the problems for which neoliberalism seems like an answer to some aren't really going away. So how do you balance that between like having them become more efficient, but also not wanting to value efficiency or like profit at the expense of like other aspects of life?
So if I can rephrase your question, is about how you can retool optimization in a way, so it's not working to reproduce in a way these ideologies. Is that right? Okay. Well, that's the question. I think that's the question. Yeah, basically. No? I think what's important, and maybe this is a way of trying to use your question to actually. The question to me is how you do that, and what methods would work. You know? And to me, it's really interesting to think historically because it allows me to, in a way, this idea of trying to understand ontology in a sense as historically constituted, and obviously history is ontologically constituted, and so that would be my. You know, I tell my students who are, you know, very smart people working on very innovative things to try not to forget to read history and to historicize whatever they're doing. Not in a way to paralyze them, because it's also easy to get paralyzed, but in a way for them not to obviously repeat the same mistakes. And really, you know, we live in a culture saturated with the idea of innovation. But innovation is only innovation if it's truly different. And so, I think that's the question, is what is truly different? And so I think that's also a lot of what you were talking about.
Yeah, it is. I'm going to have to be brief because I know we have a bit of time, but I think the important thing is to try to consider what it means to rethink those sorts of categories, process categories, without telic prerogatives. So without idealism, but without also at the same time idealizing the evacuation of idealism, because that in itself is a kind of trap. It's a regressive trap of that is typified in neoliberalism. You know, the illusions of the sort of crypto ideology of neoliberalism, of pragmatism, the illusions of pragmatism, and indeed in pragmatism itself, which you know, all forms of philosophical pragmatism or political pragmatism. We trick ourselves all the time into thinking that we're not thinking telically, you know, with goals or ideals. And it's very difficult to actually be vigilant enough or have a structured methodology that can assist in ensuring that we don't accidentally fall back into yet another kind of idealism.
Just more of an observation in a sense, but the buildings you spoke of, Matthew, you know, these sort of like sinuous buildings, in a sense, could illustrate the absolutely frictionless motion of capital and money, you know, through the world. But in a sense, you know, in contrast, in terms of the second paper illustrated how that sort of swarm thinking emerging from child's play and seemingly related to hegemony as such has resulted in this piece of convergence, which is surely true hegemony. Everything falls in here, and it seeks the spectacular. And in a sense, the buildings that you spoke of, and I really was so interested as you spoke in identifying, you know, that sense of decay and how it's played in architecture. But they do also seem to relate to what I would call spectacularism as such. You know, the edifices of neoliberalism are much more robust and speak of a harder power than they do. So I don't know if that's how that plays into the two threads of the presentation.
I think that's a great observation. I feel right. I think, I like the way you describe the edifices of neoliberalism as harder. And I think I would extend that to that they're harder in the sense that they're more callous as well, both kind of literally and metaphorically. They're less easy to cut open, like a callous on your skin. It's difficult to cut a callous. You can cut your healthy skin or your regular skin, normative skin. But they're callous and metaphorical, so it's in that they're cruel as well, and unremitting, in a way that the liberal edifices, at least, you know, liberal edifices of, say, you know, institutions of, say, justice, you know, the juridical system, the police system, you know, the ideological apparatuses of the classic liberalism, at least give the alibi for their cruelty, you know, for their necessary cruelty. They give the alibi of fairness or something, you know, kind of universals. They shield or they veil or they try to counterbalance the positives from the negatives in a way that neoliberalism doesn't care to. So in that sense, I think the question of what is symbolized, as I was saying, in decay is, I think what's symbolized is the decay of the illusions of the ideology, or ideologies that have led to what ideologies we have now, and not the it's not a realism. That's what I think. It's symbolic, but it's not a realism. Realism would not represent, in any kind of kitschy way that I suggest, that there is friction. I think what you're saying, there is friction. I think spectacle is friction of kind. There is friction in the world, you know, and in the systems of the world. It's not smooth and easy and continuous.
One really obvious example of that is, to return to this history, the schools where Papert was doing his experiments, the first ones, as a result of all these defunding patterns, they don't do well, you know. And so it's this very clear example of, in a way, the ideological, the spectacular dimension of that research taking over and papering over in a very kind of literal sense, you know, the lack of infrastructure, the lack of teachers, the lack of support, the lack of funding, literally in the same schools that these experiments were happening. And so when I was doing research, I actually followed up on one of the main schools that had been the subject of this research, and they're having terrible problems, you know, problems with their kids not having enough teachers and all of these issues. So it's, you know, I think that you have to put those things together. I think that they're related.
Nowadays, like, there is a very strong, like, I think, philosophical, I don't know if philosophical, but almost like all through the humanities, they're kind of aligned with center left or left, and they have a strong moral discourse. They have a very strong, like, person present. Like, I would say that, like, mostly right-wing politics in general, they're kind of self-aligned and self, they're more skeptical, philosophical view underneath, and like the left wings and more embracing the present. And this, like, implies that actually all the discussions embrace the adjacent future as, like, a new basis of moral discussion. Do you think this also implies that, for example, the death of the long-term project, or as you basically said, it's kind of a vision for any kind of idea that...
Yeah, it's interesting. The question of what is the present, and whether or not presentness or present is something that we can definitively encounter or then subsequently deploy as a kind of political, either as a political rhetoric, which you seem to be suggesting the centre-left does. I think that's right. I think the centre-left is broadly speaking, it's supportive of activism. It's supportive of social justice movements, which take mostly public action. And my argument, and certainly resonate with Stanley's argument, arguments of neo-materialist political philosophy, would argue that those forms of political action are entirely redundant. They actually propagate, they actually reproduce conditions and illusions and images and so forth that strengthens the given the current ideology if it can be isolated as such. What's so brilliant about Rosen's work is that it takes on this question of the relationship of the horizons of time and space in relation to their complicity as a their interactive dynamic complicity, as is played out in human action and in human thought. Such that, as I said, there's a point in which there's several pages where he talks about this third form of time, Ion. The question is how to rethink the necessity of the presentness of the present without it being dialectically idealist. So for example, you know, in historical materialism, the goal of communism is that the present evacuates the past on the future, or it destroys the past on the future. All you need is the present, because when you have the kind of profoundly distributed wealth of any type, you know, not just crude like that, but you know, wealth of access to power and, you know, resources and everything, you don't need a concept of the past and the future. You just don't need that. So the present destroys that necessarily, and for, you know, for good. So does that answer your question, or is
Dylan, if you have time.
Sure, do we need
one more, I think, and then we're
okay. I guess a question I have is why, it's not totally clear to me why, you know, there's this notion of a lot of the architectural forms that you're describing coming to before, after the fall of the wall, and so this sudden like reaffirmation of these forms in the era in which opposition to a neoliberal model suddenly falls apart, and that's sort of unclear to me why that would be. Like, why is suddenly there a need for why would there be a fascination with the simulacrum of the swarm kind of at this moment in which opposition to the neoliberal model begins to fall apart. So that's one thing that's not, doesn't totally make sense to me, and I guess maybe it's something that sort of like production kitsch and by capital or something like that, but so maybe if you could just clarify that point. And then I just have one other related point, which is your question, which is about whether there's certain like whether you think there might be some sort of underlying theological register to the notion of the swarm and its connection with maybe like this sort of like the tone of the apocalyptic that was brought up, sort of, you know, the premonition of the end of the world, and whether there is that, as long as we're talking about a symbolic function to a political symbolic that's going on in architecture here, it seems like one of the narratives that might be percolating would be perhaps a theological one.
Like locusts,
exactly.
Sure.
Yeah.
I mean, one thing that brings to mind is that you know, one of the theological aspects of the entire edifice of human existence in any religion at the moment, or any society really at the moment, is a divinely ordained sort of conception of the individual. And in equally divinely ordained, albeit, you know, as an opposite conception of the collective. So collectivity and individuation are based on a model of some sort of divine ordination of what a human is, and then also consequently what humans are. And I think that's one of the incredible contradictions of capitalism. You know, I think the kind of contradiction that Ronald's pointing out is based in that. So people can't think, it is very difficult for us to be able to think what it means to be profoundly collective, to be one, not just a collective of individuals, not with solidarity or something, you know, halfway like that, but to be profoundly one rather than a collective of individuals. It's incredibly difficult to think that, because our entire self-conception is based on a separation of us as a self from the ecology, both of ourselves as a species and us as an entity in the world. And so that, in neoliberalism, is what's one of the fascinating contradictions, is that we're both subject to rhetoric that tells us, or political forces that tell us, we are an individual, and yet we're also, at the same time, vectorized. Our subjectivity, for example, is vectorized and mobilized and deployed in functional ways via technologies like digital communications technologies, which allow us to be interactive.
Yeah, great questions. In my story, the reason that the swarm makes, I think it's really a huge appearance, there's two and they're not directly related necessarily. One is a technological, has to do with the possibility of programming, certain computing power, and a certain pedagogical projects that have been in place for whatever 2 decades that produce someone like Craig Reynolds, has access to those tools. So there's that kind of technologically deterministic aspect. But then the other one, which is really the macro, is the fact that you're confronted with an ideological conception of capitalism based on these foundations that tells the story of, in a way, perfect competition. And it's the story of perfect competition of the self-regulated market that the swarm illustrates. And that story is incredibly productive for a certain part of the population, you know, that accrues enormous amount of power because of it. In fact, it's a complete myth, it's a fable, right? I mean, there's no such thing as perfect competition, but those images provide the illusion of that. So in that sense, it's very much a fetish, I think. But it's a very productive fetish. You know, our economies are incredibly monopolistic. Incredibly so. They're dominated by these huge players, so it's very much the antithesis of the swarm, actually. So I think there's a constant need to reassert that that myth, or else, you know, that something else might come in that will break apart the kind of consolidations that it has formed.
And Greenspan said that risk had been abolished. And he really did believe that, which is, we all move perfectly together.
Well, okay, on Greenspan, I think we'll end it here. And thank you very much for coming. Thank you, Matthew.
I'm getting off.